हेलो एवरीवन, आई एम डॉक्टर योगेश पावड़े। आई वेलकम यू टू द नेक्स्ट सेशन इन जेनेटिक्स एंड मॉलिकुलर बायोलॉजी अंडर द सेम कॉम्पिटेंसी ऑफ BI 7.2। वी आर डीलिंग विद डीएनए रेप्लिकेशन, डीएनए रिपेयर, ट्रांसक्रिप्शन एंड ट्रांसलेशन मैकेनिज्म। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट ट्रांसक्रिप्शन इन यूकेरियोट्स। So, transcription in eukaryotes have been studied in detail by Roger Kornberg, who got a Nobel Prize in 2006 for his studies on molecular basis of transcription. First of all, we'll see what are the mammalian DNA-dependent RNA polymerases and what are the different types and their application in overall process of DNA transcription. First of all, it is RNA type 1 or type A. It is not inhibited by alpha-amanitin. Being inhibited by alpha-amanitin is one of the criteria of differentiating between type 1, type 2, type 3 DNA-dependent RNA polymerases. So this RNA polymerase type 1 is not inhibited by alpha-amanitin. It is located in the nucleus with about 50-70% of the relative activity of overall RNA polymerases. It transcribes a large RNA precursor gene. The bulk of the cytoplasmic ribosomal RNAs, we have discussed these cytoplasmic ribosomal RNAs and their subunits like 28S, 18S, 5.8S. We have discussed those cytoplasmic ribosomal RNAs in a video on ribosomal RNAs. So you can go back and refer to that for details. RNA polymerase type 1 transcribes a large rRNA precursor gene. Alpha-amanitin is a toxin from a mushroom Amanita phalloides. It blocks the translocation of RNA polymerase during mRNA synthesis. It blocks the translocation of RNA polymerase. Coming to the next type of mammalian DNA dependent RNA polymerase, it is type 2 or type B of RNA polymerase. In contrast to RNA polymerase type 1, polymerase type 2 is inhibited by alpha amanitin. It is located in the nucleoplasm with 20-40% of the cellular activity. So it is the second most common RNA polymerase after type 1. All mRNAs from nuclear protein encoding genes, all mRNAs from nuclear protein encoding genes, and along with that many non-coding regulatory RNAs are also synthesized, like for example small nuclear RNAs, microRNAs, etc. are transcribed by RNA polymerase type 2. Phosphorylation activates RNA polymerase 2. So we'll discuss this process of phosphorylation during the initiation stage of transcription of DNA. Coming to the next type, that is type 3 or type C, it is moderately sensitive to alpha-amanitin. So it is moderately inhibited by alpha-amanitin. It is located in the nucleoplasm, transcribes tRNA genes specifically. So type 2 RNA polymerase transcribes tRNA genes and various small non-coding RNAs like 5S ribosomal RNA, cytosolic tRNA, U6 small nuclear RNA and others. It contributes only minor activity of about 10%. So 50% type 1, 40% type 2 and 10% type 3 RNA polymerase. These are the activities of these three types of RNA polymerases. Then coming to RNA polymerase mitochondrial or MT. It is located in mitochondria. All RNAs transcribed from mitochondrial DNA are transcribed by RNA polymerase mitochondrial or MT. Then coming to transcription initiation region. This is the transcription initiation region in bacterial genes. Okay, this is DNA part which is going to be transcribed and forming this mRNA. So from this point onwards, means downstream, the transcription will occur, but this transcription will be dependent on the regulation exerted by these promoter regions. So these sequences, minus means upstream, TTGACA and TATAT sequences, these are the promoter regions for transcription of this DNA region, which will lead to formation of this primary transcript or mRNA. So this was regarding bacterial genes. Now we'll go to see what happens toward initiation region in eukaryotic genes. What are the differences? The transcription initiation region in bacterial genes and eukaryotic genes is almost similar except this enhancer part. Okay. So here also there is a DNA sequence. Downstream the transcription will occur, and upstream there is only one promoter region, that is Tata sequence. But maybe 100 to 1000 base pairs upstream of that promoter region, you'll find an enhancer. These are the enhancer regions which have effect on promoter and ultimately the transcription part of this DNA region. So there is one more check or one more level of regulation of transcription in eukaryotic gene, which is exerted by enhancer regions. So along with enhancer and promoter, the transcription will be regulated. This is the key difference between transcription initiation region in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. The enhancer regions are present thousands of base pairs away from the promoter, are often also required for efficient transcription of eukaryotic genes. Now we'll see what are the stages of transcription. There are three stages. One is initiation stage, then there is elongation stage, and there is termination stage. Okay, we'll see one by one in detail of the initiation, elongation and termination stages of transcription. So let us see what is initiation stage. In the initiation stage, there is a major role of histone proteins and the various activators, inhibitors or inactivators which affects the histone proteins activity will have role in initiation of transcription. In the higher organisms, this DNA, you know, is blocked by histones. So histones have an inhibitory effect on expression of gene, that is also called as repressors, because the nucleic acids are inhibited by or repressed by histones because of basic nature of the histones. So they are tightly bound, the DNA molecule is wrapped around the histones, and they act as repressors. The transcription is not possible until the chromatin is restructured with special regulation. So it has to be released from histone, it has to be restructured with some special regulation, and then the transcription will be possible. Let us go through this diagram. We have just seen in previous slides that there is transcription initiation region. Okay, so this is the enhancer or hormone responsive element. This will regulate the transcription process. In the resting state, the lysine residues in the N-terminal tail of the histone, these are the histone tails, and the lysine residues in the histone tails are not acetylated because it is constantly under the influence of histone deacetylase. So this histone deacetylase keeps lysine residues in tails of histone in deacetylated state, and in this deacetylated state the nucleosomes are stable. So a continuous activity of histone deacetylase will keep nucleosomes stable by keeping the lysine residues in histone tails deacetylated. The interaction of activator and regulator proteins. See, this is activator protein, this is regulatory protein, and this is co-activator complex which has histone acetylase activity. We have seen histone deacetylase. Now we'll see what is the action of histone acetylase. The interaction between activator protein and regulator protein with their control elements allows the binding of co-activator complex which have histone acetylase activity. Now this histone acetylase will acetylate lysine residues in these, you know, these are the histone tails, and the lysine residues will be acetylated. So we are making nucleosome unstable or favorable for transcription, and the histone tails will be acetylated. What does it do? It loses the nucleosome structure to form basal transcription complex. After losing the nucleosome structure, it will make this nucleosome structure favorable for transcription, and it will form basal transcription complex, which essentially consists of DNA dependent RNA polymerase 2 and basal transcription factors like transcription factor 2, X is A2H and XCG. These are the transcription factors along with DNA dependent RNA polymerase 2 will form basal transcription complex. So here you will see that this is the Tata box. Okay, this is the promoter region in the transcription initiation complex. So now we'll see when nucleosome is made favorable, what happens to that? To that Tata box, the Tata box binding proteins are attached. These are Tata box binding proteins attached to Tata promoter region of the transcription initiation complex. And there is Tata binding protein associated factor. So we have seen that transcription factor 2A2H, right? So these transcription associated factors or the Tata binding protein associated factor will bind to this transcription factor 2D. Transcription factor 2D is a large complex of numerous proteins which contains the Tata box binding protein and the transcription associated factor or Tata box binding protein associated factor. So this transcription factor 2D is comprised of Tata box binding protein and transcription associated factors, and they form basal transcription complex. So we'll see the steps of initiation of transcription. This is the Tata box. We have just seen how a basal transcription complex is formed. This transcription factor 2D and Tata box binding proteins bind to Tata promoter region. The recognition of Tata box by the Tata box binding protein subunit of transcription factor 2D initiates the assembly of a transcription complex by binding to promoter region. Then next protein to enter are transcription factor A and transcription factor B. The transcription factor A and B will bind to transcription factor 2D, which stabilizes the DNA transcription factor 2D complex. This complex needs to be stabilized. So for its stability, transcription factor A and transcription factor B will bind to this complex and recruit RNA polymerase 2 in association with transcription factor F and additional transcription factors. So after this complex, after this DNA transcription factor 2D complex, it stabilizes, then there will be a recruitment of RNA polymerase 2 along with transcription factor F and additional transcription factors, so that the next step of the initiation stage will take place. The transcription factor F, after binding to transcription factor D, it serves as a bridge between the Tata bound transcription binding proteins and RNA polymerase 2. So you can clearly see this, that RNA polymerase 2 is attached this side, then transcription factor B along with transcription factor 2B, H and E. This complex is nicely anchored on Tata promoter region by a bridging action of transcription factor 2F. Then one of the last transcription factors to be recruited to the complex is transcription factor 2H. This transcription factor 2H has an important role in promoter melting and escape. This transcription factor H phosphorylates DNA dependent RNA polymerase 2 and has an important role in promoter melting and escape. This transcription factor H has helicase activity, has ATPase activity, and has protein kinase activities. So all three activities are there with transcription factor 2H. This transcription factor 2H binds to the core and separates double-stranded DNA along with DNA topoisomerase during the elongation. So one transcription factor is carrying out almost all the necessary activities of the enzyme which is required otherwise separately. If you remember the DNA replication process, so the helicase activity, ATPase activity and protein kinase activity is exerted by different individual enzymes in the DNA replication. But here in transcription, you see the transcription factor 2H has all three activities, helicase, ATPase and protein kinase activities. Along with DNA topoisomerase, it leads to elongation stage. Then there are distant transactive factors also, which pass on signals to the coactivator mediator complex. This coactivator mediator complex will have influence of various transactive factors, and this influence will be passed on to basal transcription complex for regulation of transcription process. The promoter melting and open complex formation stage releases RNA polymerase from the basal transcription complex. This RNA polymerase is bound to basal transcription complex. The transcription is not yet started. It is just under preparation stage. The promoter has to be melted and the open complex formation should be there to release RNA polymerase from this tape or from this place on the DNA template, so that it will move forward and it will start the elongation stage of transcription. So the promoter melting will release RNA polymerase from the basal transcription complex along with few transcription factor, and it will start synthesizing heteronuclear RNA. So what is promoter melting and open complex formation? For polymerase 2 transcribed genes, and maybe unlike the other bacterial RNA polymerases, the promoter melting requires hydrolysis of ATP, and we know the ATPase activity is exerted by transcription factor 2H. The protein kinase activity of transcription factor H also leads to multiple phosphorylation of a domain in the C region of the RNA polymerase. The complete phosphorylation process in promoter melting and open complex formation is subserved by transcription factor 2H. While the upstream promoter DNA is held in a fixed position by transcription factor D. This is the large protein transcription factor 2D, right? The transcription factor 2H pulls downstream the double-stranded DNA into the cleft of the polymerase. We can simply say there is a tussle between transcription factor 2D and transcription factor 2H. The D will try to retain or fix this RNA polymerase with the transcription promoter region, and transcription factor 2H will exert all its power to leave the initiation stage and lead to the elongation stage of the transcription. So for that, the transcription factor 2H, pulls the double-stranded DNA into the cleft of the polymerase to drive the separation of DNA strands and opening of the pre-initiation complex. So it will drag the double-stranded DNA into the cleft of polymerase so that it gets separated. It will initiate the elongation process. The transcription factor 2B aids in open complex formation by binding the melted DNA and stabilizing the transcription bubble. Now, to help transcription factor 2H, the transcription factor 2B will aid in open complex formation. It binds to melted DNA and stabilizes the transcription bubble. If you remember, in case of DNA replication, we have very important role of single strand binding protein so that the replication fork is stabilized. Here, the transcription factor 2B will stabilize the transcription bubble by binding the melted DNA, and it will help transcription factor 2H to lead to elongation process. So we'll see what are the necessary steps for elongation stage. So initiation to elongation. The RNA polymerase, once phosphorylated, loses its enhanced affinity for promoter sequence. Because transcription factor 2H has phosphorylated RNA polymerase 2, it will lose its affinity for promoter sequence. Now it is loosened and it will regain its strong generalized affinity for any DNA. So there is a driving force for this RNA polymerase to enter into elongation stage. But before entering the elongation phase, the polymerase may terminate prematurely and release a short truncated transcript. This is called as abortive initiation. So if the elongation phase preparation is not proper, the initiation may be aborted with a short truncated transcript and it will not lead to the elongation phase. So that's why this stage is very important, the preparation of elongation. Many cycles of such abortive initiation may occur, before the transcript actually grows to sufficient length to promote the polymerase escape from the promoter. So the promoter region is tightly holding RNA polymerase 2 and it has to actually release itself from the basal transcription complex so that it enters into elongation stage. I have just said that there is a tussle between transcription factor 2D and transcription factor 2H. Throughout abortive initiation cycles, the RNA polymerase remains bound to the promoter. Many initiation cycles may be aborted, and throughout those abortive initiation cycles, the RNA polymerase will remain bound to the promoter. It will keep pulling downstream DNA into its catalytic cleft in a scrunching kind of motion. It will keep on dragging double-stranded DNA. So with all its force and activities, it will try to enter into elongation stage. Now, when the RNA polymerase 2 will enter into elongation process of transcription. When a transcript attains the threshold length of 10 nucleotides, it enters the RNA exit channel. So, this is RNA polymerase 2, okay? And when newly formed transcript attains the threshold length of 10 nucleotides, it enters the exit channel, RNA exit channel, and the RNA polymerase shifts into the elongation phase successfully. The polymerase breaks its interactions, all its interactions with the promoter elements. Now there is no longer activity of transcription factor 2D because H has conquered and the RNA polymerase has entered into the elongation stage. All the promoter elements and any regulatory proteins associated with the initiation complex will have no interaction with RNA polymerase 2 now because it has entered into elongation process of transcription. We have just encountered two terminologies, downstream and upstream. So what is downstream? This RNA polymerase molecule is now moving the promoter and entering into elongation phase and moving to initiate the transcription. It is moving in this direction. So the direction in which the RNA polymerase will move, that is called as downstream direction. And the direction opposite to that is known as upstream direction. For example, we have started here at 5 prime end of a gene at this point A and moved along the gene in the same direction as RNA polymerase to the point B. For example, here you are moving downstream. And by contrast, if you started at point B and moved in the opposite direction to point A, you would be traveling upstream. So this is the downstream and upstream. So don't get confused. Downstream means along the direction. Upstream means against the direction of movement of RNA polymerase. If the promoter is very strong, if it can attract many RNA polymerase molecules rapidly towards itself, many enzyme molecules can transcribe it simultaneously. So maybe after releasing this RNA polymerase 2, another RNA polymerase 2 molecule will come to the promoter. Again, the initiation phase will happen and then it will enter into elongation. So, many RNA polymerase molecules you will see along this gene which will be transcribing mRNA molecules one after the other, like that. The transcription bubble collapses down to 12 to 14 nucleotides, providing kinetic energy required for the escape. The promoter escape in eukaryotes requires ATP hydrolysis, and that is provided by transcription factor 2H. Once it enters into elongation process of transcription, it extends the RNA by adding correct ribonucleotide to the 3 prime end of the nascent RNA molecule, one by one, according to the base pairing rule, at around 50 ribonucleotides per second. As the enzyme is extending the RNA in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, it is moving in the antiparallel 3 prime to 5 prime direction along the DNA template strand. So, the synthesis of RNA is in the 5 prime to 3 prime direction, but the movement of the enzyme is 3 prime to 5 prime along the DNA template strand. This is analogous to the polarity in DNA synthesis, in DNA replication. Okay, so we'll see what is transcription bubble now. This is the transcription bubble, and it is the region of DNA unwound by RNA polymerase, containing RNA polymerase, DNA, and nascent RNA. This length of transcription bubble is 20 base pairs. Here the nascent RNA chain is remain base paired with DNA. Here the RNA chain is now bound to DNA. It is base paired with DNA template, forming a DNA-RNA hybrid. In this transcription bubble, there is constantly unwinding is happening at this end, and there is rewinding happening at this another end. The DNA double helix reforms here, displacing the RNA. This RNA is displaced from this site. This RNA molecule hangs out of the transcription complex as a single strand with free 5' end. This is what the transcription bubble is. The RNA polymerase unwinds the DNA in front downstream and re-anneals it behind in the upstream direction. It dissociates the growing RNA chain from the template as it moves along, and it performs proofreading at the same time. Proofreading of RNA chain is performed at the same time. The RNA polymerase has DNA unwinding property that we have seen, and it is aided by the topoisomerase in the unwinding process. So what is the proofreading activity this RNA polymerase is performing? The proofreading begins with separation of misincorporated nucleotide from the DNA template. So the proofreading activity is happening in real time. Once the nucleotide is misincorporated, it will immediately be removed. It will pause the transcription, and the polymerase then backtracks by one position and cleaves the mismatched nucleotide immediately. Till the mismatched nucleotide is not removed, the transcription will not be continued. In RNA polymerase, it binds at the same active site used for polymerization. So for proofreading activity, there is no separate site there. It occurs at the same site used for polymerization. And if you compare with DNA polymerase, the proofreading occurs at a distinct nucleus active site. So in DNA polymerase molecule, the proofreading activity is occurring at a different active site on DNA polymerase molecule. But RNA polymerase has only one site. At the same site, the polymerization is occurring, and the same site is subserving the function of proofreading. And the overall error rate is around 10 to the power minus 4 to 10 to the power minus 6. What are the various factors responsible for regulation of elongation process of transcription? Here the RNA polymerase does not transcribe through all sequences at a constant rate. So once initiated and the elongation process is continuing, but there will be certain regions where the transcription process will be little slow or maybe little fast. So the rate will not be constant. It pauses periodically, sometimes for rather long periods before resuming transcription. So that is a part of regulation of elongation process also, that depending on the need of protein, the mRNA synthesis will occur. The rate of polymerization by RNA polymerase will also get regulated by various regions in DNA molecule. So it may pause periodically, and after that it will resume the transcription process. There are factors like ELL family, which regulates the elongation process of transcription. It binds to elongating polymerase and suppresses transient pausing. So to continue with best possible or optimum rate of transcription, this ELL family factors will bind to elongating polymerase, and it will suppress transient pausing of RNA polymerase. So it will try to continue the polymerization by RNA polymerase continuously, uninterruptedly. Then the next factor is transcription factor S. transcription factor 2S does not affect the initiation. We have seen there transcription factor A to H, which regulate initiation process of the transcription. But here the transcription factor 2S is not affecting initiation, but it stimulates elongation. So S for stimulation of elongation. Like ELL, this also stimulates the overall rate of elongation by limiting the length of time that RNA polymerase pauses when it encounters sequences that would otherwise tend to slow the enzyme's progress. So once the ELL family factors and transcription factor 2S are bound to elongating RNA polymerase, it will limit the length of the time the RNA polymerase pauses. Unlike ELL family factors, this transcription factor 2S adds to proofreading by RNA polymerase. It stimulates an inherent RNA's activity in RNA polymerase. But this inherent RNA's activity is not a part of the active site. It allows to remove misincorporated bases. Then coming to termination of transcription, once the desired length of hnRNA is achieved, the transcription has to be terminated at a given sequence. So RNA sequences that signal the end of the transcription are known as terminators. In humans, the termination signals exist far downstream of the coding sequence, usually 1000 to 2000 bases away, the actual coding sequence. There are two types of terminator which exist. There are intrinsic and extrinsic terminators. The intrinsic terminators causes RNA polymerase core enzyme to terminate transcription on its own. And the extrinsic terminators require additional proteins to exert the action of termination of transcription. A particularly maybe polypeptide known as Rho to bring about termination. So there are intrinsic terminators and extrinsic terminators which will terminate transcription process. All the terminators may be intrinsic, may be extrinsic. Those are specific sequences in the mRNA that are transcribed from the gene. The terminators often form hairpin loops. These kind of hairpin loops are formed in mRNA molecule. These hairpins are formed because of the complementary sequences in the nucleotides in the same molecule. Upon termination, the RNA polymerase, a completed RNA chain, are both released. Here, the termination region in this DNA molecule, so the specific DNA sequence here have exerted a role of termination of transcription. This hairpin structure in mRNA molecule has been synthesized by the DNA sequence in this termination region. And when this hairpin loop is synthesized, it will terminate the transcription process. It will release the RNA polymerase and a completed RNA chain from the transcription complex. This completes the transcription process. Now we'll see what are the factors which are regulating transcription. In eukaryotic genes, there are many regulatory sequences beyond the core promoter. The transcription initiation is regulated by cis-acting elements, which contain enhancers, silencers, and insulators. So these six cis-acting elements are regulating transcription initiation. These cis-acting control elements will bind to sequence-specific transacting factors, namely transcription activators or repressors, to modulate the rate of transcription. So this part, the cis-acting elements, which are enhancers, silencers, and insulators, will affect or regulate initiation process. The sequence-specific transacting factors which are transcriptional activators and repressor, will modulate the rate of transcription by modifying or affecting elongation stage of transcription. There is good harmony between these cis acting elements and sequence specific transacting factor to regulate transcription process. These regulatory sequences can be spread over a large genomic distance, sometimes located hundreds of kilobases from the core promoter. And the gene transcription can also be regulated post-initiation by targeting the moment of the elongating polymerase. By modulating the rate of transcription, the gene transcription can also be regulated. You know, because of this regulation only, the RNA polymerase is bound to stop or halt the transcription process at a certain genetic sequence, which is prevented by the ERL family and transcription factor S. So how well genome transcription is regulated? There are factors which are enhancing the rate of transcription, and there are factors which are preventing the excessive rate or undue increase in the rate of transcription at the same time. This was regarding regulation of transcription. Now coming to inhibitors of transcription, alpha-amanitin. We have seen the role of alpha-amanitin in differentiating between RNA polymerase 1, 2 and 3. It is a selective inhibitor of RNA polymerase 2 and 3, but RNA polymerase 1 is not inhibited by alpha-amanitin. Then rifamycin, rifampicin and streptovaricin. These drugs bind to beta subunit of polymerase and it blocks the initiation of transcription. Actinomycin D, it forms the complex with double-stranded DNA and prevents the movement of core enzyme and inhibits the process of chain elongation. Because it inhibits the movement of core enzyme, elongation process will be inhibited. There is one more drug which inhibits chain elongation by binding with beta subunit of prokaryotic polymerase, that is streptoglycine, and a heparin. It is a polyanion that binds to beta subunit of RNA polymerase and inhibits transcription in vitro. This was regarding transcription of DNA in eukaryotes. This is the literature which you can refer for further studies. I thank you very much for watching this long video. Hope you have all subscribed to the channel. If you are not yet subscribed, kindly subscribe to the channel so that you'll get notifications of upcoming videos. Thank you very much once again. Keep watching, keep learning, and keep motivating us.